Albert Einstein, Boris Podolsky, and Nathan Rosen proposed a thought experiment on the concept of quantum entanglement. This led John Stuart Bell to find what we know today as a Bell inequality or Bell's theorem. The Bell inequality and Bell's theorem are very famous, but they are hard to explain without using difficult math. This is physics made simple. I'm going to illustrate Bell's theorem with a spin the wheel toy and two ways to play the game, so you can get a clear understanding of the physics behind Bell's theorem. Let's get started. Particles are entangled when they are generated, interact, or share spatial proximity in such a way that we cannot describe the quantum state independently. The typical representation of entanglement looks like this. A laser is sent through a crystal. High-energy photons can split into pairs of two low-energy photons with perpendicular polarization. This means that if one photon points up, the other will point down, so their states are entangled with each other. Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen propose a thought experiment where we create two entangled particles, for example with the system above. We then move the two particles very far apart, and we observe something fascinating. Particles are in a quantum state. Like with Schrödinger's cat, we can only know if it is alive or not by opening the box. As long as we don't look, the cat and the particle are in an unknown state. If we measure the property of one of the particles, the other one immediately adopts a defined state as well. But we haven't measured the other particle, and they are so far apart that the information will have to travel faster than the speed of light, which is not possible. There are two ways to explain the observation of quantum entanglement. The first explanation is that the information traveled faster than the speed of light to the second particle. This explanation was criticized by Albert Einstein as spooky action at a distance. The quote became famous because it summarizes so well what we observe. But let's continue to the second explanation of quantum entanglement. The second explanation is that there is some hidden information that predetermines the result of the measurements before we performed it. The second explanation uses the assumptions of realism and locality. Realism means that the property exists, whether we measure it or not, it's just there. Locality means that the information cannot travel faster than the speed of light and particles are only influenced by their environment. If the second explanation is true, then quantum mechanics is incomplete because it doesn't entirely describe the particle's properties. This is what we call hidden local variables. John Stuart Bell improved this line of thinking with Bell's theorem. If we perform independent measurements on each particle, then they each contain hidden variables. Because they each contain half of that information, it creates a constraint on the correlation that is known as a Bell inequality. But Bell then shows that quantum physics correlations violate this inequality. The correlation we observe in experiments doesn't match the constraints that he computed if we had hidden local variables. Since we see that quantum physics works with our experiments, something must be wrong in the reasoning. The only way to make the Bell inequality work is to assume that the hidden variables of the particles are not local. There is something that lets particles interact instantaneously, with information traveling at an infinite speed. Many people have tested this finding by measuring the properties of entangled particles many, many times. They observe that, yes, it doesn't seem that the particles have local hidden variables because a rule John Stuart Bell found for correlation with the Bell inequality would be respected and it is broken. Let's say I have a spin-the-wheel toy and I'm playing with Albert and Marie. They have to guess on which half the spin will land on. The trick is that Albert and Marie each get to decide how to split the wheel. They pick an angle to represent their choice. So basically, if the spin lands within 90 degrees of that angle, so half the circle, they win. In the easy cases, they can both choose the same angle, so they will always win together or lose together. They can also choose opposite sides with angles different by 180 degrees. That way, there will always be a winner and a loser. They can also pick angles 90 degrees apart. The wheel is then split into four parts. A quarter of the time you both win, a quarter of the time you both lose, and half the time there is one winner and one loser. This is simple, but it gets tricky. Bell's theorem tells us that reality doesn't work that way. In particular, it says that the amount of time you both win or lose together is not exactly the same as the amount that your halves overlap. Let's change the game a little bit and include some strange rules. Instead of spinning the wheel, I hide the wheel and wait for Albert and Marie to ask me for results. Marie comes and asks me if she won. I flip a coin. If it's head, I tell her that she won. If it's tail, I tell her that she lost. So my answer is random and unrelated to the wheel. I haven't spun the wheel, but now Albert comes and asks me if he won or lost. I look at the wheel. If I told Mary that she won, I consider Mary's angle to see if Albert won, not his angle. If I told Mary she lost, I consider the opposite angle of Mary's angle to see if Albert won. Because I'm not using Albert's angle, the results are different. If Albert and Mary had the same or opposite angles, the result would match, and there would be no randomness. If there is a difference between the angles, the results would partially match. There is a correlation. These are strange rules, but experiments in physics show that reality works with the strange rules. The state of the spin the wheel toy and Mary's choice of angles are the local hidden variables in Bell's theorem. The Bell inequality shows that while the game appears to work like that, there is no hidden spin the wheel with information, and information seems to travel instantaneously between the two particles. It is spooky at a distance, as Albert Einstein would say. This is an essential information for quantum physics that doesn't solve everything, but it states one more time that there is no true reality that we could measure if we knew everything about it. Uncertainty is real, quantum entanglement is real, and it is not due to some knowledge we don't have about the particles.